The Delta variant is said to make up more than half of all new COVID-19 infections in the U.S. That's disturbing news given the most recent information that the Pfizer vaccine is only 65% effective against that strain, even though it is 95% effective against the traditional others. So what does this all mean? Joining us to discuss is Dr. Shikha Jain with UIC. Good morning to you. Lots of confusion going on with this, Dr. Jain. So let's break down the effectiveness of each of the three vaccines that we are dealing with against the Delta variant. So an Israeli study said it was only 65% effective when it came to the Pfizer vaccine. J&J says that its vaccine lasts 8 months and protects against the Delta variant. And Moderna says its vaccine is highly effective against this. Now, since this is the variant of greatest concern right now, which of these vaccines is the best in combating this?
So I want to clarify something from the Israel study that you mentioned, Sylvia. So yes, you're right. The percentage was about 65%. They said that it's effective, but that's effective at getting COVID at all. It is still in the 90%, over 90% effective at preventing very severe illness and hospitalization. So the Pfizer vaccine is still very, very effective against the Delta variant when it comes to if you are going to get severely ill or hospitalized. That 65% that you mentioned is more for just contracting COVID. COVID-19 at all. Most people who get COVID after they've been vaccinated have very mild symptoms. The thought is because Pfizer and Moderna both work in a similar way, that Moderna is going to have similar numbers where it's still highly effective at preventing people from getting very sick and hospitalized, but is likely a little bit less effective, probably in the 60% range, but again, we need data to come out first to say that with confidence against the Delta variant, just getting COVID at all. Then Johnson & Johnson, we're again looking, you know, if you remember at the beginning, Johnson & Johnson was a little bit less effective even from the beginning as compared to the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines. Now it's looking like with the new data that's coming out that Johnson & Johnson is hopefully also still effective for at least that 8 months period and possibly longer. But again, we need more information about the Delta strain. It does seem that it is effective. The question is going to be how effective.
Okay, now let's talk about the Delta variant here, because there are reports that the symptoms for this type of COVID-19 are actually different from what we've experienced, the loss of taste, the loss of smell. Tell us the difference in the symptoms and what people should look for.
Yeah, it's really hard actually, because the Delta variant has been showing up with signs of just typical cold symptoms. So a sore throat, a runny nose, feeling run down. And so the concern is people may be walking around with COVID and think that they just have a regular respiratory virus. We're seeing an increase in regular respiratory viruses now that Illinois has removed the mask mandates for indoors and people are moving around more without masks, without social distancing. So a lot of the symptoms with the new variant are very similar to just your everyday cold. So again, if you start having any symptoms that would be indicative of a cold, it may be beneficial for you to get tested just in case you actually have COVID and not just your regular respiratory virus.
Okay, let's talk about unvaccinated people, because some health experts are calling them variant factories because they are saying they not only put themselves at risk, but also posing a risk to everyone if they become infected. How big of a problem is this, and how concerned should we be about this?
I think we need to be very concerned. As we know, there's new variants that have been popping up throughout this pandemic. And especially, you know, most recently with this Delta variant, we're seeing it's much more contagious and it's easier for people to transmit it to each other. So as viruses continue to spread, there's a chance for them to mutate into more infectious, more dangerous, more contagious viruses. And when that happens, eventually we're worried that we're going to find a variant that escapes our vaccines, meaning we get to a variant where our vaccines aren't effective. So absolutely, these unvaccinated populations where we're seeing the spread and the surges of COVID-19, we're very concerned that those are the populations where we're going to see new variants pop up that may eventually evade our current vaccines that we have available.
Okay, so with the rise of this, combined with news that some of the variants are not as effective as a lot of people, vaccines that is, are not as effective for this particular variant as we have discussed, is it time to bring back masks? Do you think that that's even a possibility, that we could be told it's time to start masking up again?
I think it's definitely a possibility. As we know, Illinois, Chicago is an international travel hub and travel has opened. So we're seeing people fly in from other countries, from other states where the vaccine rates are also very low. I can imagine, especially as we start moving towards the fall, there's going to be an increase in numbers. And similar to what we saw last summer where our numbers got very good and then it started to become colder weather again, we started to see our numbers going up. Right now, you know, as you know, our group Impact put out a statement last week encouraging people, whether they were vaccinated or not, to be wearing masks indoors when they're in public spaces, because we don't know the vaccine status of other people in the store or in the restaurant we're in. So we are anticipating, looking ahead, looking at what's happening in other countries such as Israel and looking in the UK, we're concerned that we're going to start seeing numbers going up across the country, and indoor masking is again going to be something that's recommended and possibly even mandated, especially in areas with low vaccine uptake.
Okay, let's talk about children and those children who can't be vaccinated and the others. There's also news this week that 160 infections were linked to a Texas church youth camp, COVID infections, and they were ages 6th through 12th grades. What do you want to say to parents considering sending their children to camp? You have youngsters. Is this something you feel comfortable doing?
Absolutely, a great question. So I will tell you, my kids are 7, 3, and 3, and they all wear masks anytime they leave the house. They are in camp, but their camp is very, very good at requiring everybody to wear masks. I think there's a lot of camps that have opened up with really great policies where kids and counselors and anyone who is there is required to wear a mask, which I think is really important. If you're a parent and you're considering sending your kids to camp, number one, if your kid is over 12, I would say please get them vaccinated. That is the first and foremost thing you need to be doing. If your child is not yet eligible for a vaccine, then I would strongly encourage you, whether there is a mask policy or not, please have your children be wearing masks when they're socializing with other people, when they're in camp. And I encourage people to ask the camp directors what their policies are, and encourage you to talk to the camp directors and ask for everyone to be wearing masks. Because again, we know that even if you have been vaccinated, you can still contract COVID, and we're learning more as to how transmissible it can be. Meaning, if you're vaccinated and you get COVID, is it possible that you can transmit it to other people as well? So again, if you're considering sending your kids to camp, get them vaccinated if you can. If you are not able to get them vaccinated because they aren't old enough yet, then make sure they're wearing a mask and make sure the camp has policies in place to protect your children.
Dr. Shikha Jain with UIC, as always, thank you for joining me this morning. Appreciate your time.
Thanks, Sylvia.